Hello everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel, Dr. Balkis of Ophthalmology Tutorials. Today we will discuss about intraocular pressure, the normal range of intraocular pressure, the physiological and pathological factors which influence intraocular pressure, which are the various instruments which are used to measure the intraocular pressure, their principle and the method of measuring the intraocular pressure, advantages and disadvantages of each instruments. Okay. So before going to the chapter, let me give my first shout out to Purnima, who actively participated in the question answer session and gave correct answer to all the 5 questions which I had asked in my previous video. Congratulations, Purnima. I also want to thank all my subscribers and who are watching my videos constantly. I am really grateful to all of you for your encouragement. Okay, so let's begin with the intraocular pressure. So what is intraocular pressure? It is the pressure within the eye which is keeping the eyeball distended to carry out the normal functions of the eye. Okay, and it is majorly contributed by the iris, humor as well as the vitreous. Okay, so these two factors contribute to intraocular pressure. Normal intraocular pressure, it can be defined as the pressure range within which there is no damage to the retinal nerve fibers. Okay, so it varies with each individual. For some persons, even the low IOP can damage the retinal nerve fibers, and some persons even the high pressure may not damage the retinal nerve fibers. So it is given in a range. Normal IOP is usually 15 with 2 standard deviation of 2.5. okay, so it comes to around 10 to 21 millimeters of mercury. Okay, coming to the physiological factors which influence the intraocular pressure, if you consider the sex, up till 40 years of age there is no predilection to male or female sex. After 40 years, increase in IOP is more common in women. Okay, so when you consider the age, newborns have the IOP in the range of 11.4 plus or minus 2.4. Infants, they have in the range of 8.4 plus or minus 0.8. up to 4 years it is about 13.7, and after 12 years it becomes as that of the adults. Coming to the diurnal variation, that is the variation of intraocular pressure in morning or afternoon or in the evening hours, usually there is increase in IOP, or the IOP spike is more in early morning hours. Okay, some studies say that it is seen in even in the late afternoon also. So it is always better to do diurnal variation of tension, that is you should measure the intraocular pressure too early throughout the day. Okay, starting as early as possible, then there can be a spike in intraocular pressure early morning hours, like in 6 to 8 o'clock, but through rest of the day the patient may have normal IOP. So measure the intraocular pressure throughout the day with a gap of 2 hours. You may get spikes early morning hours of 6 to 8 o'clock. In those cases you may miss the spike or the raised intraocular pressure in the early morning hours. In that case you may label the patient as normal tensor glaucoma. So there are few factors which increases the intraocular pressure, like it increases during sleep in the lying down position. Okay, maybe because of the fluid shift towards the head end position, Valsalva maneuvers, when they are using high resistance musical instruments, when there is decreased gravity, like in the head down position, in some of the yoga postures like Shirsasana, there can be increased in IOP. And also smoking transiently increases the intraocular pressure. So you should give importance for all these when you are taking history, otherwise you may miss the cause for raised intraocular pressure. There are certain drugs which can increase the intraocular pressure, like steroids which are used as topical eye drops or as an ointment to other skin conditions also can increase the intraocular pressure. The anticholinergic drugs, sulfonamide drugs, antipsychiatric drugs, and also scopolamine dermal patches which are used for some skin conditions, aerosolized atropine which is used for COPD patients. So all these can raise the intraocular pressure. If possible, you can avoid these drugs and shift to other drugs so that the intraocular pressure is controlled. Next, coming to one more important aspect, that is general anesthetic drugs, because most of the congenital glaucoma cases need examination and anesthesia. But these anesthetic drugs can itself influence the intraocular pressure and give various result. Okay, so it is important to keep in mind these anesthetic drugs. Like most of the general anesthetic drugs which are used to sedate or anesthetize the patient usually drop or decrease the intraocular pressure, except the ketamine, whereas the succinylcholine and the sexmethonium transiently increase the intraocular pressure because of the contraction of the extraocular muscles. And the laryngeal masks have less effect on intraocular pressure compared to the endotracheal tubes. So these are the points which you should keep in mind when you are taking the patient under general anesthesia. Okay. So there are some illicit drugs which influence the intraocular pressure. Lysergic acid diethylamide, that is LSD, tends to increase the intraocular pressure, whereas heroin and the marijuana tend to decrease the intraocular pressure. Next is the exercise which can influence the intraocular pressure. In some patients with advanced glaucoma, the exercise can even hamper the central field of vision which they are having. In some cases of pigment dispersion syndrome or pigmentary glaucomas, the exercise can lead to release of the pigments from the iris and lead to rise in the intraocular pressure. So in these cases, patients can use low dose of pilocarpine to keep the pupils in meiotic state, thereby avoiding the IOP spike. Even the normal eyelid movements have an effect on intraocular pressure. Like even the normal blinking, the IOP can rise up to 10 mm of mercury, and with a hard eyelid squeeze, the IOP can increase up to 90 mm of mercury. And the widening of the eyelids tend to increase the IOP by 2 mm. And widening of the eyelids tend to increase the IOP by 2 mm of mercury. Some of the eye conditions can also influence the intraocular pressure. Like anterior uveitis patients may have decrease in the intraocular pressure because of the decreased aqueous production, or they may have increase in the intraocular pressure because of the release of the inflammatory cells which block the trabecular meshwork and leading to raised in IOP. Whereas the retinitis RD patients will usually have decrease in the intraocular pressure. Coming to some of the systemic diseases which influence the intraocular pressure, the obesity and increased body mass index tend to raise the intraocular pressure. Even the sleep apnea patients tend to have increased incidence of primary open angle glaucoma, whereas myotonic dystrophy patients have usually decreased IOP. Hyperthermia can again increase the intraocular pressure. So these are the factors which may influence the intraocular pressure. So always give importance to these factors when you are taking history and find out the cause for raised intraocular pressure. Next, coming to tonometry, that is nothing but measuring the intraocular pressure. So tonometry. So the intraocular pressure can be measured either directly or indirectly. So broadly you can classify the tonometry into direct methods and indirect methods. Direct method is nothing but you are directly cannulating into the anterior chamber and measuring the variations in the intraocular pressure. That is also called as manometry. But this is very invasive procedure and this is used only for the research purpose. Otherwise, there is no much role of direct tonometry or manometry in measuring the intraocular pressure. In indirect methods, we have manual way of measuring the intraocular pressure, indentation methods and the ablation method. Okay, so the manual method is nothing but how you check for swelling in surgery. Okay, it is almost similar to the fluctuation test what you do in surgeries when you are examining a swelling. So just ask the patient to look down, thereby you are avoiding the tarsal plate when you are palpating, and also you are not raising the intraocular pressure because of the eyelid closure. Ask the patient to look down and take the support of forehead with the other fingers, and with the index finger of one hand just gently press the globe, and with the index finger of the other hand just feel how firm is the eyeball. It can be soft, it can be hard, or it can be normal. And as you examine more number of the eyes with the manual method, you will appreciate whether the eyeball is hard, normal or soft. Okay, so that is about manual method of checking the intraocular pressure. Indentation method of tonometry, you are applying a fixed force or the fixed weight over the cornea. Okay, so this is the cornea and you are applying a fixed force here for the cornea, and it will produce some amount of indentation. It is the some amount of indentation, okay, indentation of the cornea. So how much indentation this fixed force or the weight can produce is measured by using Schiot's tonometer, and then the further calculations are made. So the main difference between the indentation and the applanation tonometer is, in the indentation tonometer, with a fixed force there is some amount of indentation produced, and this indentation is measured with the instrument. In indentation tonometer you saw there was indentation of the cornea, but whereas in applanation tonometer it is just the flattening of the cornea which is achieved. So there are two methods, like you can fix the area of cornea how much you want to applan it, and then measure the force which is required to flatten so much of the considered fixed area, and that is converted into the intraocular pressure. Hope you understood the major difference between the indentation tonometer and the applanation tonometer. In indentation tonometer, the force is applied, the fixed force is applied, and the indentation which is produced in the cornea is measured and then converted to the intraocular pressure. Whereas in applanation tonometer, the fixed area is flattened. So to flatten that fixed area, how much force is required is calculated, and that is again converted to intraocular pressure.
So this is the broad classification of the tonometry. We have direct method and the indirect method. I have already explained about the direct method. It is not of much clinical use, maybe confined to the research purpose. In indirect method, we have indentation tonometry, okay, digital tonometry and applanation tonometry. In indentation, we have various types like Schiot's tonometry, which is well known to everyone. And even the impact or rebound tonometry, that is iCare tonometry, is also a type of indentation tonometry. The transpalpebral tonometry and even the dynamic contour tonometry or the Pascal tonometry, they are all based upon the indentation principle. Step is the digital tonometry, which is more useful clinically, and with the experience one can approximately tell whether it's hard, soft or normal eyeball. Applanation, we have two types, that is with a variable force and with a variable area. So when the force is variable, the types are like Goldman tonometry, Perkins tonometry, Tonopen, pneumatic tonometry and non-contact tonometry are the NCT. When the area is variable, we have one type of tonometry, that is called as Maclakoff tonometry. Okay. So coming to the Schiot's tonometry, which is based upon the indentation tonometry. I have already explained about the principle of this indentation tonometry. Coming to the parts of Schiot's tonometry, we have handle here, which will help to hold the instrument. This is the foot plate, which rests upon the patient's cornea, and this is the plunger, okay, and this is the liver, okay, this is the short arm of the liver and this is the long arm of the liver, and this is the reading scale over which this liver will move, giving the reading. So in this box you can see one more important part, that is the metal block, okay. So before checking the IOP on patient, you should always keep this Schiot's tonometry on this metal block and see whether the liver is corresponding to the zero scale. Otherwise, you may need to clean the Schiot's tonometer again and make sure that the liver touches the zero before you check on the patient. We have two weights here, okay, 7.5 grams weight and 10 grams weight. This instrument itself has inbuilt weight of 5.5 in this plunger. So whenever you check the IOP with this weight without putting in any of these two and the liver is showing the reading less than 3, then you have to go to 7.5 grams of weight, which should be put here, recheck the IOP. Again, if it is going below 3, even with 7.5 grams of weight, then you may need to go to 10 grams of weight and do the procedure. So this is about the instrumentation. So coming to the procedure of Schiot's tonometry, first make the patient to lie down in supine position, anesthetize the cornea with a topical anesthetic agent, and then ask patient to look straight at the ceiling. And then after checking the Schiot's tonometer, hold at the holder and gently keep the Schiot's tonometer over the cornea and look for the reading here. So this is the procedure of tonometry. So after you get the reading, there is a standard nomogram called as Friedenwald nomogram, where you have to see the readings and corresponding intraocular pressure depending upon the weight you have used. Suppose if you have used 7.5 grams of weight and the reading is shown as 5, then the intraocular pressure is 25.8. okay, so this is how you read the Friedenwald nomogram. So coming to the advantages of this Schiot's tonometry, it is very easy to do, can be done by technician or the assistant, very helpful for mass screening, and it gives accurate results over wide range of intraocular pressure. The disadvantages are the readings can be inaccurate when the rigidity of the sclera is variable, like in case of increased scleral rigidity or the decreased scleral rigidity, the IOP may not be reliable. So what are the conditions where the ocular rigidity is more, like in case of hypermetropia, chronic glaucoma, use of chronic vasoconstrictor drugs. Okay. The conditions where the ocular rigidity can be low, like in case of high myopia, use of miotics, secondary to the retinal detachment surgery, intravitreal injection of gases and the vasodilator treatment. Even the thick and steep corneas can give false high results of intraocular pressure when you are using Schiot's tonometer. So next is how you disinfect the Schiot's tonometer. So after each use, tonometer, plunger and the foot plate should be rinsed in water, followed by washing with the alcohol and then wiped dry with a lint-free material. So this has to be followed, otherwise the results will not be reliable. So this is all about Schiot's tonometer. Next, moving on to the Goldman's applanation tonometry, which is based on Imbert-Fick law, which says that the weight or the force required to flatten any spherical surface is equal to the pressure within the sphere multiplied by the area which is flattened. Okay, here a sphere means which is perfectly spherical, dry and perfectly flexible and thin. But in case of eye, it is not a perfect sphere first of all, and there is moisture because of the tear film production which will lead to surface tension. Okay, and because of the lack of flexibility, it requires certain force to flatten the cornea. Adding to this, the cornea is of almost 520 micron thickness, so there is variability of the force on the anterior surface as well as the posterior. To overcome all this, that is to make the surface tension equal to the force required to flatten the area, we have to flatten 7.35 millimeter square of posterior surface of cornea. So to achieve this posterior surface cornea flattening, we have to flatten 3.06 mm square of the anterior surface of cornea. Okay, so in other words, when we flatten area of 3.06 mm, we are inducing 7.35 mm square of flattening of the posterior surface, which will make the surface tension cancel with the force which is required to flatten the cornea. So thereby this equation becomes very apt. The force which is required to flatten the surface becomes directly equal to the intraocular pressure. So now let's see the instrument. So this is the Goldman supplementation tonometry. This is the main part, that is the prism. It has a unit and which is fixed to the hackslit type of slit lamp. The instrument contains a flat circular plexiglass plate of around 7 mm area, which will flatten 3.06 mm of the corneal surface. So here when we use 0.1 gram of force, it is almost equal to 1 millimeter of mercury. So when you turn the knob, the readings in the knob correspond to 1 gram, 2 gram, 3 grams, like that. So when you multiply that by 10, you will get the actual intraocular pressure. Okay, the procedure of Goldman supplementation tonometry: ask patient to relax first. Okay, make sure that patient is relaxed. Then the chin is placed over the chin rest and the forehead touching the headband. Okay, anesthetize the cornea and stain the tear film with a fluorescent dye and gently move this prism towards the cornea under blue filter. Okay, under cobalt blue filter, you will observe the changes there. Okay, so once the prism touches the cornea, it is actually producing a circular image like this, and because of the prisms which are used in this applanation tonometry, it is divided into two semicircles like this. Okay, and these semicircles should be of appropriate width. Okay, otherwise if it is too thick or too thin, you may get false readings. So once you see these semicircles, just move the knob so that the inner surface of two semicircles meet each other. That gives the intraocular pressure reading. Okay, so this is how it looks when you see through the slit lamp. These are the two semicircles, and the inner surface of these two semicircles are opposing to each other, and that gives the intraocular pressure reading. And one more thing which you should always keep in mind in doing Goldman supplementation tonometry is, after you do this test, make sure that the cornea is clear. Means observe under slit lamp only with a cobalt blue filter and look for any corneal abrasions which are induced by tonometry. So be gentle when you are doing the Goldman's tonometry procedure. Let's see the potential errors when you are doing applanation tonometry, that is from the corneal thickness. This is ideal for the central corneal thickness of 520 micrometers. A very thick cornea can give rise to false high reading. So similarly, a thin cornea will give rise to false low reading. So what is the correction factor? For every 10 micron variation in the cornea, we have to subtract or add 0.7 millimeters of mercury. Okay, depending upon whether it's a thick cornea or thin cornea. The second factor which influences is the corneal curvature. That is, the IOP is underestimated when there is with rule astigmatism, and it is overestimated when there is against the rule of astigmatism. And there can be variation of 1 millimeter of mercury for every 4 diopters of the astigmatism. So how to overcome this? In this prism, there are two markings actually, a white mark and the red mark. Ensure that the red line corresponds to the axis of least value. Okay, and then you do applanation tonometry. Otherwise, your Myers will be distorted. In case of irregular cornea also, because of the scarring, you will not get good Myers, and you can't do the Goldman's tonometry. Another factors which are causing errors in the readings are like too much of fluorescein, irregular cornea, and the tonometer is not calibrated properly, and repeated tonometry when you do, and the pressing of the eyelids or the globe, squeezing of the eyelids, all these can lead to potential errors when you are doing the plantation tonometry. Next part is about disinfection. So the plantation tonometry prism can be disinfected by soaking the tip for 5 to 15 minutes in 70% isopropyl alcohol or hydrogen peroxide. That will be sufficient to disinfect the Goldman supplantation tonometry. Coming to advantages of Goldman supplantation tonometry, this is the gold standard when you are measuring the IOP. Okay, the results are very much accurate. Disadvantages of Goldman tonometry are, it requires lit lamp and patient has to sit, so you can't do in bedridden patients. You have to use the anesthetic agent. There are chances of upgrading the cornea when you do the Goldman supplantation tonometry. Moving on to non-contact tonometry. This is the non-contact tonometer. This is the patient's head position. Okay, so you are making the patient to keep his chin here and head is resting over the head band. Here a air puff is produced from the machine. Okay, so this air puff deforms the cornea and measures the time or the force of air puff that is required to create a standard amount of corneal deformation. It is based upon the principle of applanation tonometry only. The main advantage of this NCT is it is used for screening purpose because the time taken is very less. Okay, and there is no need of using anesthetic agent. Disadvantages are, in eyes with very high IOP or very low IOP, the readings may not be accurate. So coming to the tonopen, it is a handheld, self-contained, battery-powered, portable instrument. Okay, the probe tip contains a transducer that measures the applied force. So the procedure is, you just anesthetize the patient's cornea and press the button here and keep the probe over the patient's cornea. It will take 10 readings and gives the average of the 10 readings over here. Advantages are, you can use this tonopen even in the distorted and the edematous cornea, over the bandage contact lens also, and in the patient's in supine positions also. Coming to the rebound tonometer or the iCare tonometer, here it measures the IOP by bouncing these small plastic tipped metal probes against the cornea. The results are comparable to the Goldman supplantation tonometry in normal patients as well as in post keratoplasty patients. So it is also easy to use, a portable machine. Coming to Perkins supplantation tonometer, the principle and procedures are almost similar to the Goldman supplantation tonometry, only there is no need of slit lamp here. It is a self-illuminated cobalt blue filter will be there, and with that you can measure the intraocular pressure. Advantages are, like, no need of slit lamp. Even in the supine position, you can use this instrument to measure the intraocular pressure, especially when you are taking the patients under examination, the pediatric age group patients or the patients who are uncooperative, when you want to examine under anesthesia, this Perkins supplantation tonometry will be helpful. Coming to dynamic contour tonometry, which is very interesting. The principle here is totally different compared to your applanation and indentation tonometry. Principle is, by surrounding and matching the contour of a sphere, the pressure on outside is equal to pressure on inside the sphere. So the tip of the probe matches the contour of the cornea here. The pressure transducer, which is built in the center of the probe, measures the outside pressure, which is equal to the pressure inside the eyeball. So the IOP, which is recorded here, is displayed upon the liquid crystal display or the LCD. And this is a promising new technology that may give better information about the actual IOP. This is independent upon the corneal thickness and the contour. That is the main advantage of this dynamic contour tonometry. This may give accurate readings as that of the Goldman's tonometry. So this is about the dynamic contour tonometry or the Pascal tonometry. So coming to the next one, that is pneumo tonometer. This is also based upon the principle of applanation tonometry. It measures the IOP by flattening the cornea with a graded flow of gas against a flexible diaphragm. This is very useful in scarred cornea, edematous cornea, and over the soft contact lens use. Next, coming to non-corneal transpalpebral tonometer. Here the IOP is measured through eyelids overlying the sclera. Okay, the response of free falling rod rebounding against the tarsal plate gives the measurement of the intraocular pressure. So here there are no chances of damaging the cornea. So this is non-corneal transpalpebral tonometer. Ocular response analyzer. It is nothing but an adaptation of the NCT, that is non-contact tonometer. The principle is same as that of the NCT, that is air puff is used, but it corrects the effects of corneal hysteresis on IOP measurement. So gives better reading compared to your NCT. Coming to the last part, that is tonography. Okay, just a similar term. It is not the measurement of the intraocular pressure. Tonography is a non-invasive technique for determining the facility of the aqueous outflow. Here a digitalized Schiotz tonometer is used. Okay, first a reading is taken with a Schiotz tonometer, and the tonometer is kept for 4 minutes on the eyeball only, and the IOP is measured again at the end of 4 minutes. If the readings are taken in microliters of aqueous outflow per minute per mm of mercury, so if it is more than 0.2, it is normal. 0.2 to 0.11 borderline. Next, moving on to our question answer section. The questions for this video are: what is the name given for direct method of tonometry? What is the normal diurnal variation of intraocular pressure? What is the principle behind applanation tonometry? What are the two advantages of pneumotonometer? Which is the promising instrument in tonometry that may be used in future? I am waiting to see the answers from all of you. Please do actively participate in this question answer session.